Thank you, everyone. So I was actually in between two papers, and now I realize the other paper that I didn't pick would have been a better fit. So we just completed a review article with Mario Molina, who's in the back, on machine learning methods for sociology. So I think it's in conversation with what David has presented, what Paul has presented, a lot of what you've been arguing. So anyway,
I'll send it.
But what I'm presenting today, I think, I hope, is equally exciting. So it's basically a series of papers that are driven mostly by students who are here. So Linda Zhao from Harvard and Flavia Ngantar, who's at Columbia. And the paper with Linda, which I'm presenting today, builds a computational model and comes up with a hypothesis and then makes a prediction. And then the paper with Flavia is trying to test it. So I'm only going to talk about the first part. So we have a simple idea in this paper. So we know that social networks provide access to resources. Then anything that affects network formation process will have implications for inequality. And then the simple idea was the basis for our earlier paper with Paul DiMaggio. And in that paper, we focused on homophily, so the tendency of actors to associate with similar others. So we argued that homophily tends to lead to segregated networks and eventually to intergroup inequality in outcomes for which our alters offer positive influence. And we considered the case of internet adoption in the US. So there's still a racial gap in subscription to home internet service. So whites in the US are much more likely to adopt internet at their home. And this gap actually remains even after you control for income and education differences. So what explains this racial gap or intergroup inequality? So we argued that first, there are initial differences, right? So some groups are more advantaged when it comes to technology use. So people who are more educated, who are richer, are both likely to know about this technology and also be able to afford it. And in the US context, this group of educated, richer people tend to be white. Then, based on many empirical studies, we noted that networks are clustered according to the same characteristics that are related to adoption. Things like education, income, and race affect who we associate with. And finally, technologies like internet have what economists call network externalities. So this means that they become more valuable to you the more people in your network use it. So if many of my friends use email, if many of them are on Facebook, then I have all the more reason to adopt this technology. If nobody I know is using these technologies, then I have little reason to adopt it myself. So if we put these three conditions together, when there's an initial gap in adoption by status, when there's homophily in network formation with respect to these same status characteristics, and when the technology has network externalities, then we argued that social networks would exacerbate existing inequalities. In other words, we would see inequality that cannot be explained by income and education or status differences alone. So the networks would actually hurt inequality. Now, the way we kind of made this argument is we had an agent-based model, and these models typically relate on synthetic made-up agents. So you basically create these agents, you give them attributes, you give them rules for associating with one another, you give them rules for behavior, and then you observe what happens when you let them interact. You observe emergent behavior. Well, in this paper, we actually took a different approach. Because we wanted to say something about the digital divide in the US, we wanted to replicate the population structure here. So we sampled our agents from the General Social Survey, which is a representative survey of the US population. And as I'll argue in a minute, this choice had implications for what we could study and what we had to leave out. So in this kind of, the paper with Paul is actually the backbone of what we're doing with Linda. So in that paper, we have this kind of logic. There is a mechanism, homophily, that affects network structure. That structure then affects diffusion of a practice, and then intergroup inequality in that practice. But homophily, as you can imagine, is not the only mechanism that can affect network structure. Another mechanism that we're considering here is consolidation. So what is consolidation? It's basically the correlation between different characteristics in a society. So in a highly consolidated society, if you tell me what your income is, I can pretty much guess what your education is, where you live, and all these characteristics about you because they're so highly correlated. Now, in our paper with Paul, we kind of left this out because it was fixed in the data. Because we sampled our agents from the GSS, the consolidation there reflected the consolidation in the US society at large. So we could not really vary it. And in this paper with Linda, we're doing exactly that. And consolidation actually first appears in Blau and Schwartz's work, The Cross-Cutting Social Circles. And there, they make this very strong statement that consolidation, along with homophily, are like these two parameters are key to network formation and social cohesion. Now, specifically, what they argue is you need low homophily and low consolidation to ensure cross-cutting ties between diverse groups of people. And this is a necessary condition for social cohesion. So the logic is actually quite straightforward here. If I don't select my friends based on their similarity to me, then I'll have a diverse group of friends. And if I live in a society where different traits are not correlated, so even if I don't make as much money as you do, I can run into you in a neighborhood bar. That means, again, opportunities for interaction. And in a society where ties are diverse for everyone like this, then everything is cohesive and we get along well. And then there were some empirical tests of this. So these are mostly Blau students. And some findings are as follows. Researchers found that low homophily and low consolidation are linked to higher rates of interracial marriages in communities and high intergroup interactions in organizations. So if you think about it, these findings are concerning the first part of the argument, that homophily and consolidation are affecting network structure, how people interact with one another. In a new paper, relatively new paper, Damon Centola tested the second part of this argument, whether the network structure also affects diffusion or social cohesion. And the way he thought about social cohesion was a diffusion of a common practice. How is it that a norm becomes adopted by everyone in a society? And how do homophily and consolidation contribute to that? And he used an agent-based model of network formation and diffusion. And here, he created synthetic agents. And then he gave them particular attributes. And he controlled the distribution of these attributes. And this way, he controlled consolidation. So in one scenario, for example, if you were high on one attribute, this meant that you were high on all the other attributes. So this is a high consolidation scenario. In a different setting, you know, your position in one social dimension does not affect your position in all the other social dimensions. Now, he also kind of gave agents particular rules for associating with one another. And this is how he controlled homophily. Again, in one setting, you associate with everyone randomly. And in another scenario, you basically pick people who are similar to you. And then the network structure looked quite different under these different scenarios. So this is our replication of the Santola model. And these are different network graphs that emerge for different values of these parameters. So when homophily and consolidation are both low, we see the network as being kind of one big giant component, right? So there are no kind of cliques that are emerging, no structure. Everyone can be reached by everyone else in the network. As we increase homophily and consolidation, as in this kind of middle figure, we see some structure building up in the network. So suddenly you have these cliques forming that are densely connected within, and they have some connections across. And as we increase these parameters, the splitting of the network gets more extreme. In this case, there's high clustering within kind of each clique, and then even sparser connections across. And this is all in line with Blau and Schwartz. As we're increasing homophily and consolidation, we see more balkanization in the network structure. But then there's something else that we can see from these graphs. These two parameters are not independent in their effects. So if we keep homophily low and keep increasing consolidation, that does not really create the same kind of balkanization. And similarly, if we keep consolidation constant and increase homophily again, we don't see the same kind of splitting happening. So this is the first insight that emerges from Santola's study, that these two parameters are actually interacting in their effect on network structure. Then the main question of Santola was, how does this all affect diffusion of a common practice? And this was his operational definition for social cohesion. And to test that, he gave agents particular rules for adopting this practice. So in one scenario, all it took was one agent to adopt the practice. So if anyone in your network adopted, you would adopt in the next time period. In a different scenario, the threshold for adoption would be higher. So it took two people to adopt or three people to adopt. And he found a really interesting pattern. So when the diffusion process is simple, in other words, all it takes for you to adopt is a single adopter in your network, then low consolidation and low homophily lead to successful diffusion. And this is entirely in line with Blau and Schwartz's claims. But then, when the diffusion process is complex, so this means that you need at least two people in your network to adopt a practice, then the dynamics actually change. Then medium consolidation and medium homophily lead to successful diffusion outcomes. And if we unpack the logic here, in the simple contagion case, say you want to adopt a technology. So it's a low-risk endeavor. And one person, a random person, telling you about it is enough for you to follow up on that idea and adopt the practice. So in this case, a well-connected network is necessary. And as we saw in the network graph, low homophily and low consolidation give you that, a well-connected network where everyone can be reached through everyone else. But then, consider a riskier practice, and migration is a good example. It's kind of the main topic that I study. If a random person comes and tells you about the opportunities in the US, then perhaps this is not enough for you to take up migration, try to cross the border without documents. But if you keep hearing the same information from multiple people, then you become more likely to adopt it yourself. Now, in this case, a well-connected network is not sufficient. You need overlapping ties among people with similar characteristics. So if you're someone who's connected to many prior migrants, which would be possible under some homophily, then you would be more likely to take up the practice. And actually, many social behaviors diffuse through such kind of complex contagion process, as Michael and Damon has written in a different paper. Okay, so basically, this is our replication of the paper that shows kind of Damon's results. On the z-axis here, we're seeing the diffusion outcomes. And on the x and y-axis, we have consolidation and homophily. And as I said, we see successful diffusion happening at the middling levels of both of these parameters. And we see that they actually also interact. The value of homophily affects the effect of consolidation. Now, so what does this all mean for inequality? Up to now, I did not go further than Damon's study. So if we go back to our earlier work with Paul, we have homophily leading to network structure, diffusion of a practice, and inequality. Now, we did not consider consolidation with Paul. Damon did consider consolidation, but he did not inquire about inequality. In his model, all the agents are identical. There are no status differences between them. So what we're doing with Linda is basically asking this question, what if there are status differences, and what are the implications of these differences for inequality? So we have an agent-based model with status differences among agents, and we assume that status affects adoption probability. So high-status individuals are the first adopters, and everything diffuses from them. And our homophily and consolidation are our key parameters. So I'm not going to go into the details of this model. Basically, our algorithm is simple. We set the level of homophily and consolidation, and we're using the same architecture that Damon used, which is based on Duncan's work with Dodds and Newman. And this architecture basically helps us define homophily and consolidation. And we form ties based on that. And the innovation that we bring is we take one dimension, one social dimension, to indicate status. And we assume that there are three status groups, high, medium, and low. And adoption threshold is an inverse function of your status. So if you're a high status person, the contagion process is simple contagion. So your threshold is one. Only one person in your network is enough for you to adopt. If you're a medium status person, it takes two people. If you're a low status person, it takes three people. Okay. And then we run the model. So if we look at the overall results, we can still replicate Centola's results. In other words, introducing the status-based adoption thresholds does not challenge or change any of his results. But it actually changes the results that we found with Paul. So here on the right-hand side, I'm showing those results where we only considered homophily. And this is kind of hard to read, but I'll kind of walk you through it. So basically, what we're showing here is the proportion of adoption, the diffusion rates across time for different levels of homophily. So when homophily is high, as in this kind of darkest line, diffusion is very fast in the beginning. So adoption diffuses very fast among the highly advantaged people, but the equilibrium level is lower than the lower homophily cases. In other words, homophily makes adoption faster, but it hurts the equilibrium adoption level. Now, what happens when we consider consolidation? We see the same outcome, but only for high consolidation cases. In other words, homophily is only hurting diffusion, only bringing the plane down when consolidation is high. Now, because we use the US data here, and because the US data are highly consolidated, we found homophily to be hurtful to inequality or adoption. But here, if we look at kind of all the possibilities that we can see here, actually homophily can be helpful in diffusion in these regions. So basically, having some homophily is better than having no homophily. And in some cases, having a lot of homophily is better than having little of it, especially when consolidation is low. So we're qualifying some of the findings. And then our results about inequality also need to be qualified. So with Paul, this figure shows the odds ratio of adoption comparing high and low income individuals. So in every case, high income individuals adopt faster or at higher rates than low income individuals. But the inequality is higher the higher level of homophily. Basically, we claim that inequality increases with homophily. Now, in our new model, this is true under high consolidation. So this is the same odds ratios of adoption under different scenarios of homophily. And we see that inequality increases with homophily, although not linearly. High and medium homophily cases are overlapping, but they're higher than low homophily. And this actually pattern is reversed when we look at low consolidation worlds. In low consolidation worlds, actually low homophily leads to the highest level of inequality. And high homophily case has lower inequality. And the reason for that is precisely if we look at this region where homophily was helpful in diffusing a practice, this is precisely the region where inequality outcomes are more favorable for higher inequality cases. Now, just kind of the takeaway here is we pay a lot of attention to homophily in sociology and social science at large, but consolidation is actually a structural parameter that's also key to network formation and diffusion. And Blau and Schwartz were not entirely right in their claims. As Centola showed, homophily can actually help diffusion. And Paul and I were not also entirely right. We argued that homophily would hurt and make inequality worse. But we can actually see that under certain circumstances, homophily can help inequality or alleviate inequality. And then the advantage of these parameters, like homophily and consolidation, is that these parameters can be measured with population level data, with sociodemographic data, without having network information. So the question we're asking in our empirical papers is whether we can use these parameters as a proxy for network structure in understanding diffusion of different behaviors. So I'll stop here. Thank you. Paul.
This is great.
This is the first time Paul is seeing this, by the way. I'm just
The one question that occurs to me is if are there actual societies that are in the low consolidation level, or is this more of a theoretical kind of thing?
Yeah, so this is kind of what we're trying to get at. So I think in this case of if you think about the parameter space where we're seeing all the possibilities, in the very low consolidation, perhaps it doesn't exist in reality. But what we see is that there's enough variation even among communities that seem very similar, that that it's kind of plausible to test this. So with Flavien, the project that we're looking at, the question that we're looking at is the diffusion of migration from Mexican communities. So we have data from 161 communities. And when we kind of plotted the differences in terms of their levels of consolidation, there was quite a bit of kind of spread in that. Whether these correspond to theoretical limits or a theoretical way kind of we've defined consolidation, it's not clear. But when we split these communities in terms of consolidation groups, we can still detect these effects. So, and Linda has a bunch of empirical studies that she's doing from all sorts of settings to answer these questions. Yeah. Yes.
I don't know if I can verbalize it, if I remember the original Watts and Dodds and Newman paper, so wasn't homophily constructed as the following way? You have multiple dimensions.
Yeah.
I'm going to choose one dimension.
Yeah.
Then there's an exponential function of some sort.
Yeah.
And then I homophilize on that dimension.
Exactly. The dimension on which you're closest.
Right.
The minimal
and so
distance.
There's some kind of schizophrenia.
Yeah.
No, that's a negative word. I don't mean it that way. But
yeah.
So that means that consolidation is going to play a major role because you've selected one dimension.
Absolutely.
And you're ignoring all the others.
Absolutely.
It only works if
Absolutely.
It's highly correlated with the others. I imagine you chose differently, right? You'd have some kind of multivariate homophily and actually consider all these dimensions simultaneously.
Were you a reviewer on this paper? No. I'm just, it hasn't been published. It's in the review stage, but this is exactly what reviewers said. So we experimented with different measures. Yeah, so initially, I'm just joking. So it's fine even if you are. So basically, yes. So we kind of experimented with these different measures. So we tried kind of mean across many different dimensions. That didn't quite work out. In other words, we couldn't replicate Santolo's results when we played too much with this measure. So then it kind of became tricky. Do we want to stay true to the original model and just kind of consider the implications for inequality? And in the end, we came up with one multivariate measure that seemed to replicate the original results, which was multivariate. So we considered several dimensions, not all of them. I think it was 3 or 5. And we took the minimum among those 5.
Instead of just looking at the social dimension in which people were the closest, we took an average of the closest 3 or 4.
Yeah.
And I think that's like sort of still realistic because if like Centola has like 32 dimensions, I think we use 16.
Yeah.
I don't think it's realistic really just to average all of them, but
exactly.
Maybe an average of a subset of them in which they're close might make that kind of...
And we reached out to Damon as well to get his input on this because in his paper, he says that the result is robust to alternative, measures. And he basically gave us the Axelrod example, but that we couldn't make that work. But then he also said, this is the right way people kind of define social distance. Being close in one dimension is sufficient to feel affinity to someone else. And then there's some psychological research that supports that. But to answer your question, the results are sensitive to definition of that distance. Absolutely.
My question is somewhat methodological, and you it was very nice that you replicated David Sintula's agent-based model and then move on from there. And the question is, to what extent are results that we get from agent-based models robust in the sense that they tell us something about the real world?
Yeah.
It's clearly an exploration of a mental exploration of implicit models or explicit models that you use to set up the modeling. But it isn't quite data, is it?
Yeah.
And again, I've done 2 papers using agent-based models, and I come out of it not really confident that I have a finding. Per se, in that it doesn't really engage the data and the confirmation you get from working with real data. So it's a question I'm throwing out because I'm curious to know what you think.
Yeah, so there are different schools of thought on this, right? So some people try to make these models calibrated to some empirical context, and then some people, like Damon, and we do in this paper, just kind of create a completely hypothetical world. And in that case, I think it's more to make an argument of plausibility and to generate a hypothesis that can later be tested. So in other words, I don't think that this is how the world works, but what we're showing here is that under certain circumstances, it's plausible that homophily would better diffusion outcomes and alleviate inequality. And this is not a deduction that Blau and Schwartz could make because they didn't study this interactive environment in this setting. So I don't see it as data like you. I see it as kind of a theoretical exercise that helps you.
Because I remember once we ran I organized a workshop at Russell Sage Foundation where we talked across the Great Divide, and they had a half were economists, half were sociologists, and Michael was there and presented one of his agent-based models, and I sat next to a MIT economists who denounce it right away as something that they used to do in economics but don't any longer do because it has been so unreliable as a image of the world as it is.
I would love to hear what Michael thinks about this, but it gives you things that nothing else would give, right? So it gives you these hypotheses.
Yeah,
so.
And I agree with you. I think we've learned a lot from Schelling and the evolution of cooperations.
My question is more specific. So one thing that apparently is important here, and that the dynamics are very sensitive to the ratio of the number of agents to the size of the opinion space, the number of dimensions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So as the number of dimensions increases, that space explodes in terms mm-hmm. of all the combinatorics,
mm-hmm.
and holding the number of agents constant, then the density or the number of agents who occupy any given profile,
yeah.
you know, changes very
yeah,
quickly.
Yeah.
And so as it gets, as the size of the space increases relative to the number, you have large numbers of agents who are not anchored by neighbors who share their attributes. Yeah. So have you played around with the robustness of the results to the number of dimensions holding the number of agents constant?
We have, and if I, you know, Linda can correct me on this, but I think the results are more sensitive to having too little dimensions than having too many of them. And this is consistent with what Centola did. I think his results didn't hold when dimensions were fewer than, is it 10? Like below some threshold, it didn't hold, but above that threshold, it seemed to hold. So all of that robustness check holds here, but I would say what Arnaut raised in terms of like this using this ultrametric distance that, you know, Duncan and others, and you know, that's kind of, that's key to the outcome. Delia and then Paul.
I mean, on the question of dimensions, you can figure out ways to infer them from real world data.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a student who is working exactly on this.
Yeah.
Starting exactly from your starting point in terms
yeah.
of Blau and so on. And in his case, he used this data, the GSS data, how many people do you know?
Yeah.
That specified people in different categories, like blacks, whites, Republicans, and so on. And instead of like analyzing this data as dyadic, he builds like a multidimensional space, and then yeah. he reduces it to the number of dimensions that are really meaningful, meaning like black and income don't really make a huge difference. So these two dimensions overlap, you just got it down, get it down to
yeah,
one.
Yeah.
So conceptually, like this is just an example of
yes,
one can go about it, but the bottom line is the number of dimensions that are relevant, let's say in Western society, for several sorts of processes can probably be derived,
mm-hmm.
And we can decide whether it's 30, is in the range of 32
yes.
or in the range of 5 to 10.
I was going to say basically that, but less articulately, but that Blau actually explicitly says salient dimensions are the ones that matter, and he defines salience in terms of an effect on the likelihood of interaction, statistical effect.
Yeah, that's helpful because this is kind of one of the questions with all this empirical work, like which dimensions do we include, and lacking network data, it's just kind of a guessing game. I think with Flavia we have like 10 different versions of homophily and consolidation measures based on different combinations of these, because we want to see if it's robust to inclusion or exclusion of some of these characteristics. Yeah, so that's helpful. Yeah.
So the way we thought about this problem
yeah.
in the original paper was, so first of all, homophily, you don't pick the minimum distance. When you're doing the type formation exercise, you randomly pick a dimension.
Exactly.
And then you randomly pick a dimension.
Exactly. That's what we're doing.
Some parameter.
That's what we're doing.
Right?
So it's not the same univariate.
Right?
It's like different dimension at each time.
The minimal metric comes in when you compute your social distance.
Exactly.
So when your perceived distance from someone is the minimal distance. But the actual type formation mechanism, you just randomly pick a dimension and you randomly pick a time.
Exactly.
Now, we had zero consolidation in the original model. By definition, the dimensions were independent,
mm-hmm.
right? So that seems, and then you know, subsequently we played around with a more complicated version which did have consolidation
mm-hmm.
in it. And basically that just sort of increases the number of dimensions you need to get the same answer, right? So another way, maybe
I see.
Given that this is very complicated
yes,
and there's
yes,
lots
yes,
of things,
yes,
so
yes,
one
yes.
way to simplify it might
yes.
be to say, well, you know, and I think this relates to Delia's point, right? Let's say you have 20 dimensions, but you know, 18 of them are highly correlated with two of them,
yeah.
right? So now we could just take a model with two dimensions that are independent, right? And then you would get essentially the
yes.
same results.
Good
so
point.
Then you just then you get this, you know, this kind of analysis where now you just have the number of effectively independent dimensions and your homophily.
Yes, that makes sense. Yes, that makes sense. Okay, thank you.